Good morning.
Good morning.
It's an honor and a privilege to be back here at Christ Church and to be gathered with God's people as we turn our hearts to God, and that all who are able to stand as we begin with the order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is sure.
Amen.
Let's confess our sin in the presence of God and of our neighbors. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
We raise our voices in praise with our gathering hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. Together, let us pray. Glorious God, your generosity waters the world with goodness, and you cover creation with abundance. Awaken us in a hunger for the food that satisfies both body and spirit, and with this food fill the soul-filling world. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first lesson is from Isaiah, the 55th chapter. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear, and come to me. Listen, so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And so to the sky, the dear.
The second lesson is from Romans, the 9th chapter. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite any of my younger friends for just a little bit of time of sharing. There are no strict age parameters on that, by the way. But good morning. How's everybody doing?
Good.
All right. Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. I don't remember this being quite this low here. I hope something like this has never happened to you. Did you guys do any activities this summer that were... What?
I did softball.
Softball?
I did baseball.
Baseball. My granddaughter did T-ball. She was terrific. They didn't lose a single game. They don't keep scoring T-ball. But there was a couple of days this summer, you remember early on, it was really kind of smoky and hazy and this, that, and the other. Well, we got up in the morning at our house, and we were a little surprised by that, right? It was like, it was pretty terrible. At our house, it smelled like somebody had made a campfire and like thrown the leftover hot dogs on it. It just is terrible. Well, we got up, and my daughter was actually, she was playing T-ball, and my granddaughter, and she had swimming lessons. And we woke up kind of late, and this and then, so we just things. And I'm not one of these kind of guys who, does your mom, you don't have a cell phone, do you? Thank goodness. Good job, parents. But we jumped up, and I didn't look at my phone or my computer. We went right over to the pool for swim lessons, and usually there's like lots of cars, and there weren't any cars there. How come?
Because they canceled it.
Because they canceled it, yeah. Well. Yeah, so you had games canceled, Well, what did that kind of do your day? It's okay. You wanted to play. You wanted to have your game. You wanted to do something. So it was a little disappointing. Well, in a minute, I'm going to read a story from the Bible. That it's actually where one story starts and another one starts about a day when Jesus was having a really unexpected and kind of sad and confusing day. Now, I hope you don't have many days like that. Every day is just fun, 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 fun. Like the first day of school is coming up, right?
16 days,
in case you're counting. Okay. Well, I'm glad that you're excited about that. There are days when things go not as we planned. And there are days in life when things can just seem like a big, smoky, confused, I'm not in the right place kind of day, like my granddaughter and I are having. I'm glad you guys handled that better than we did. But even in those days when it just kind of seems like everything is going wrong and people don't know what they're doing, I have a lot of days like that. God knows what's going on and gives us a chance to put things in a way that brings love and happiness to other people and to ourselves, even when it feels like the world is not very interested in those things. I'll tell you what. Let's say a little prayer together. You can say it after me. Dear God, some days things seem pretty crazy, but we know that we can always count on you. We know this because of Jesus. Amen. Hey, hope you guys have a great week. Thanks for coming up, and you look sharp. Thanks. Let's see what's what. I might just have to stay right here. I don't know. But we'll see that. This is the Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And when Jesus heard about the beheading of John the Baptist, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place and the hour is not late. Send the crowds away so they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said, "They need not go away. Give them something to eat." The disciples replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. Jesus said, "Bring them here to me." And Jesus ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over from the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As I hinted in my sharing with the young people, within the story of the broader story of the gospel, Matthew's story of Jesus, we get right out here at the end of the 13th and the beginning of the 14th chapter. Things are not looking great. You can look it up. I recommend you do. Take a look. When all else fails, read the instructions, I'm told. But at the end of the 13th chapter of Matthew, it tells Luke's or Matthew's remembrance of Jesus coming to the synagogue in his hometown of Nazareth. and it does not go well. It just says that he was rejected. I could look it up, I suppose, but this is where the famous saying about, a prophet is not without honor except for in his own town. He is summarily rejected, and there's been a kind of a flow in the things where opposition to his ministry has been building, and this is kind of like, things are looking very promising and much acclaim, but suddenly things are not very exciting, and real setback. And on the heels of that comes this report that John the Baptist, about whom earlier it had been reported had been sent to prison, and more so in Matthew's telling of the story than the others, there's this back and forth. John sends word through his disciples to Jesus, are you the one or should we look for another? There's this kind of almost correspondence between the two of them and the hope that is arisen not only among John and his circle, but the whole community of Israel about who this Jesus is. And Jesus has sent back word and says, well, tell John what you see. The sick are healed. The poor are fed. The downtrodden and excluded have good news preached to them. And anyone who does not take offense to me, I welcome. And now this word comes back that John has been executed. And actually in the reading, if you see, even you can find this in the room, it says, John, we start with in chapter 14 on verse 13. Well, the story in verses 1 through 12 is the story of the business that's going on over at Herod's palace. I'm going to touch on that a little bit. They're kind of having a party. It's Herod's birthday party. I got a birthday party for this granddaughter that I mentioned this week. I think slightly fewer things are planned than King Charles's coronation this spring. Not quite, but certainly not the expense. But her mom and her auntie, who flew in from Atlanta yesterday, have all this elaborate things going on. But nah, well, you are not invited. I'm sorry. And you are fortunate. No. But it's Herod's birthday. And there are all these machinations about John, who has proclaimed the public scandal around Herod's behavior and his shameless things. It's kind of PG-13. You want to know, kind of go all the details here. But John has just been, publicly decrying the wrong around all these things. And Herod's wife is terribly upset about the shame that's been heaped on her and this business about the stepdaughter has made this dance and gets all this acclaim, and he says, you've done such a great job here at the birthday bank. He says, you can have anything you want. Oh, and by the way, this elaborate feast. Now that's what people do on the, but even more so than now, although sometimes I wonder if the difference isn't as great as we might imagine. The high and the mighty know how to throw a party, while most folks have, on their best day, just enough to get by. And we'll touch on that in a minute. And the daughter, the stepdaughter, who has entertained them with this amazing dance, and Herod says, "What do you want?" And he is completely disarmed in front of all his guests, where she says, "How about the head of John the Baptist on a platter?" Ooh. But because he's made such a big deal out of it, he has no wiggle room, and so it is ordered, and John is dispatched, and John's head is brought to the party on a tray, to the horror of our sensibilities, not only the grisly public sign that it is, but it confirms that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, as was once said. And what should have been a joyous, happy day is turned into about as ugly a moment as we can imagine. And that's the report that makes Jesus decide to withdraw and go to a place by himself. And you wonder if Jesus says, at that particular moment, maybe it is time just to get out of here. That's what's going on here in the 14th chapter. But guess what? It was like the old, what was it, the old country song, you know, make the world go away. Jesus is not even afforded that opportunity. Because the hopeful and needful world keeps chasing after him. They follow him from the towns. And when he gets there, the crowd is still there. And I don't know about you or me, but I don't think anybody would have said, you know what? That's enough. But he doesn't. And he says, he saw them and he had compassion for them and he cured their sick. And it says, when it was evening, the day kept unfolding all day, and as we used to say, all day and half the night, they were still there. And finally, the disciples, who I don't think are exasperated, but they're just kind of being practical, he says, all right already. Let him go home. Let him go into the village. And it's, you know, we've been out here all day and half the night. You're tired. They're tired. We're hungry. They're hungry. Let him go. I don't think Jesus was being spiteful, but I think he was just being, he had a vision of what was right in front of them, and he said, no, that's what anybody would do. I don't think he's scolding or, you know, tricking. He just said, why don't you give them something to eat? And I love the response of the disciples. He goes, we don't have anything. Well, we got next to nothing. We got five. I used to mark this on the back of my hand in ink. It's different versions. He says, we got 5 loaves and 2 fish. I used to get the inside. I used to write it on ink in the back of my hand. But he says, we got nothing. Well, we got next to nothing. We got 5 loaves, probably like little pizzas of pita bread, this, that, and the other. I've been to the Middle East. There are things. Yeah. And 2 fish, probably 2 pieces of dried fish. That's probably like fish jerky, smoked and dried, enough for probably 2 people to have a reasonable little something. And we're told the crowd was 5,000 men and the women and children. Sorry, that's just the way that Matthew wrote it down. Some people would have left the women and children out. So at least that's to Matthew's good credit. And Jesus says, okay, that'll do. And he thanks God for them, and he says, start passing it out. And the story's a little unclear. It says, they all ate and were filled. Okay. And they took up what was left over, 12 baskets. But I think it's that word. And they all ate and were filled. Okay. Miracle? You bet. But what sort of miracle? Frankly, I don't know. There have been books about this thick written about them. I took a class in the seminary about the Gospel of Matthew, and our professor specifically said, tell me what happened. And we all went, what? It's been over 40 years ago, and it still leaves me a little surprised. I couldn't find my class notes, thank goodness. So what is it? What's the miracle mean? Is it a magic trick? Is it a display of God's awesome power? You bet. But what makes it a miracle? Well, there's a couple of different possibilities. Certainly it's the physical supply. The fact that what seemed to be nothing multiplies. It's often called the miracle of the multiplication. Who's my young friend over here? Remind me of your name. What grade will you be in this year? In third grade, did you start doing multiplication in math class? It is kind of amazing, isn't it? How 2 becomes 4, that becomes 8, becomes, let's see, 8, then becomes 64, and 64 times 8, it's just like, so multiplication is kind of fantastic. So that's one possibility. How 2 loaves becomes 4 loaves, it becomes 16, it becomes 64. I can't do 64 times 64, I'm sorry. So the miracle could be that. But maybe the miracle is also The inversion of outlook. It might have been easy for the disciples to kind of throw up their hands and say, we are out of luck and out of time, and this is nothing but a mess. So kind of like my friends at the recreation department, let's just cancel everything. It's the only choice that we have. But instead Jesus says, no, we can do something right here, right now, with what we have. Maybe the miracle, in part, is God's Spirit and promise letting us see in the midst of what the world sees as hopeless, the beginning of something new. Five lousy pieces of bread and two pieces of fish, yeah, that'll work. Maybe the miracle is God allowing us to see at the worst possible circumstance the greatest potential for joy. Maybe the miracle is those moments when Jesus, broken heart over his beloved cousin John, he saw not a moment in which he could have easily said, I've had it. What is the point of trying to help these people? Oh yeah, that's right, they're my people. They're my family. They're God's promise to me and to Israel and to the whole world that the kingdom of heaven is at hand right now at our worst moment. Maybe the miracle is that God's promise not only fills every soul, but there are 12 baskets still full of hope. Sounds like a miracle to me. Amen. With our brothers and sisters throughout the world and the whole church, we boldly confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. You gather your church together by the Holy Spirit. Inspire all the baptized to proclaim your abundant love throughout the world. Guide us in the mission of the gospel through word and deed. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You cherish your creation from the smallest microbe to the largest mountain. Protect fragile ecosystems. Send favorable weather. Supply food and water to nourish creatures and raise us up to care for all that you have created. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You desire peace and justice in the world. Instill within all political leaders your desire. Support the work of international peace organizations and provide relief for those in war-torn areas. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You comfort those who are hurting. Accompany those who are alone. Heal those who are sick. Provide for those who hunger or thirst. Console the bereaved. Bring joy to the sorrowful. And attend to all who call on you, especially those that we say aloud or silently in our hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You place us within communities for mutual support and love. Reveal yourself to us in worship, fellowship, and ministry with our neighbors. Provide for feeding ministries and food banks in our area, that we share your abundance with all who hunger. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for this community of faith, and for its call committee, for your wisdom and love. Give us holy indifference that we may be indifferent to our own will. Through your Holy Spirit, help us to be unwilling to be anything but your will. Give us patience and guidance as we seek to know what you would like us to do. Bless all that we do so that we can be what you bless. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We greet one another in this peace.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The song is obviously based on the Old Testament story of Daniel, which is a quick refresher. The king of Babylon had passed a law that nobody could worship anyone except him. And Daniel knew about this law, but he continued publicly to pray three times a day, and that's why he got thrown in the lion's den. We know the rest of the story. The lions didn't eat him.
Thank you. I heard about a man one day who wasted not his time away. He prayed to God.
He prayed to God every morning, noon, and night.
He cared not for the things of Baal. He trusted God who never failed. He prayed to God.
He prayed to God every morning, noon, and night. Oh, Daniel served the living God while upon this earth he tried.
He prayed to God.
He prayed to God every morning, noon, and night. He cared not for the king's decree, but trusted God to set him free. Oh, Daniel prayed every morning, noon, and night.
They locked him in the lion's den because he would not honor men. He prayed to God.
He prayed to God every morning, noon, and night.
The jaws were locked and made him shout. God soon brought him safely out. Oh, Daniel prayed.
Oh, Daniel prayed every morning, noon, and night. Oh, Daniel served the living God while here upon this earth he tried.
He prayed to God.
He prayed to God every morning, noon, and night. He cared not for the king's decree, but trusted God to set him free. Oh, Daniel prayed every morning, noon, and night.
Now, brother, let us watch and pray like Daniel did from day to day. He prayed to God.
He prayed to God every morning, noon, and night.
We too can gladly dare and do. Pray to God, he'll see us through. Oh, pray to God.
Oh, Daniel prayed every morning, noon, and night. Oh, Daniel served the living God while upon this earth he tried.
He prayed to God.
He prayed to God every morning, noon, and night. He cared not for the king's decree, but trusted God to set him free. Oh, Daniel prayed. Daniel prayed every morning, noon, and night.
We invite all who are able to stand. Let us pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good gifts. Fill us with these gifts of your creation and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, a good and joyful thing that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. We remember that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all of them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts. Christ given for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity in all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Receive God's blessing. The God of steadfast encouragement, grant us to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus.
I'll play by the house rules.